हरे कृष्ण. सो वी कवर्ड वर्स 39 एंड 40 लास्ट वीक, विच वॉज एक्चुअली बुद्धि योगा, राइट? एंड वी टॉक्ट अबाउट हाउ भक्ति कैन प्रोटेक्ट अस फ्रॉम द मोस्ट डेंजरस टाइप ऑफ फियर. एंड द मोस्ट डेंजरस टाइप ऑफ फियर इज टू एक्चुअली गेट एन एनिमल लाइफ. फ्रॉम ह्यूमन बर्थ वी कैन फॉल डाउन टू एनिमल फॉर्म ऑफ लाइफ. नेचर इज वेरी इकोनॉमिकल. सो इफ समबडी इज लिविंग लाइक अ डॉग, what are the characteristic of a dog? Dog has no cleanliness. Dog eats anything that it gets practically. It sleeps anywhere. If some human beings are living a life like this, then mother nature, prakriti will say, why waste a human body for this person? Let him get a dog's body. That way he is also not embarrassed, others are also not embarrassed by him. So this is the greatest fear, that we don't degrade ourselves. And this human form of life is an opportunity for us. You know, we can either do urdhvam gacchanti sattvastha, either we can go to the higher planets, madhyatisthanti rajasa, or we can remain in this earthly planet, or adho gacchanti tamasa. We can go down. We can go down in this material, you know, to lower species of life. Right? All of the options are available to us. So this is the most dangerous type of fear. Degrading ourselves is the most dangerous type of fear. And bhakti, once we start bhakti, this danger is gone. We don't have to worry about degrading ourselves, because we'll be guaranteed a human life, because bhakti is possible only in human life. Bhakti is not possible in other forms of other bodies. We cannot do bhakti in other bodies. So Krishna is assuring here, saying that even a little advancement, even if we chant Hare Krishna once, that gives us some progress. That is some progress. Right? And the more we engage in bhakti, the more we will progress. So if we finish 5% in this life, we will start with 6% in the next life. Or we'll start with 5% and progress from there. So this bhakti is, it is actually a treasure. It is our wealth, which will be carried on life after life. Because it is the property of the soul. It's not the property of the body. Property of the body ends with this body, isn't it? We possess so many material things. Can we carry any of this? I think I had told you the story of a king and, king once appoints one fool. King is very materialistic. Had I shared this story? Anybody remembers?
Yes.
Good. Okay. Everybody remembers, right? So we should not become like that king. Just always bothered about material things around us, comforts, earning money, becoming big, name, fame, la puja, pratishta. We're not going to take any of that. We don't even know whether we're going to retain all of it all our life. Even if we retain, let us retain, okay, Lord Krishna willing. But we're not going to take any of that. Not going to take any of that. So it's a waste, isn't it? Isn't it a waste to work our whole life for something which we cannot really carry with us, right? It's not going to come with us. Right? So bhakti is not like that. Bhakti is going to come with us. Bhakti is our property, really our property. Not something which is going to get destroyed. So these verses describe the glories of bhakti. Okay, so we're going to read more verses on this. So we are going to now read verse 41. Vyavasayatmika buddhir rekeha kurunandana bahuchakahinantascha buddhayopavisayinam. So it says, those who are on this path, on this path of bhakti, they are resolute in purpose. They are resolute. They are determined. They're single-pointedly focused. And their aim is one. They have only one goal in life. Oh, beloved child of the Kurus, the intelligence of those who are irresolute is many-branched. So Krishna is giving a hint here for those who want to seriously practice bhakti. So he's saying the intelligence of those who are not resolute is many-branched. What does that mean? Many-branched means, if suppose say we have to do... If we have to do only one thing, all our energy, intelligence, everything is focused on one thing. Now, if we have to do five things, right, then our intelligence has to get split. Our energy has to get split, right, for each of those things based on the complexities or based on how important those things are. You know, Krishna is saying, become vyavasayatmika buddhi. So we have buddhi, intelligence, make it vyavasayatmika. What is vyavasayatmika? In the purport, Srila Prabhupada explains. Vyavasayatmika means strong faith that by Krishna consciousness, one will be elevated to the highest perfection of life. Strong faith in Krishna consciousness. That by doing Krishna bhakti, I will accomplish the highest perfection in life. What is the highest perfection in life? Anybody wants to share your thoughts? What is the highest perfection of in life? What do you think is the highest perfection in life? Request some participation. What happened? Our group is very silent. Now you, all of you should come to our Sunday Kannada group. You know, devotees are like jumping up and down. They want to contribute. You can share. You know, it makes it more lively. Yeah. Yes. Padma Mataji, Rohit Prabhu.
Attain moksha.
Become pure devotee.
Okay. To attain moksha.
To become Isha. Pure devotee.
Isha is saying, become a pure devotee. Okay.
Back to Lord.
Going back to Lord. Okay.
To fall in love with Krishna.
To fall in love with Krishna. Okay.
To do the prescribed duty.
To do the prescribed duty. Okay. So many options are there.
Detachment. From.
Detachment. Prashant is saying to get one's own swarupa. So, highest perfection in life. But nobody said earning money, becoming a millionaire, making lakhs of money, rupees. So that is not important for you, all of you, is it? Money is not important. Position is not important.
Those are important, but yeah, some realization is there that that is not 100% happiness, maybe.
It is not the perfection of life.
Yeah.
It is something that if it comes, it's fine. And I've told this multiple times in the past. Whatever will come to us by the grace of Krishna will come. By us doing more, nothing more is going to be accomplished. Or, right? So that whatever is required will come. We don't have to worry about. But the highest perfection of life is Krishna Prema. Ravindra Prabhu said, Krishna Prema. To serve Krishna with love and devotion. This is the highest perfection in life. Bhakti, whatever you want to call it, right? Bhakti. But even in bhakti, there are different types of bhakti. So bhakti can be done in different mellows or relationships with the Lord. There are five mellows. Actually, we can say four. Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya and Madhurya. So there is Dasya Bhav in which we can serve the Lord. Dasya Bhav is mood of servant, being a servant. Initially when we start bhakti, all of us are in Dasya Bhav. We consider ourselves as servants of Krishna. Then when we move, when we make progress, we have to make progress. Now it's not artificial. We can't move from now Dasya Bhav to any of the next levels, Vatsalya, Sakya, Vatsalya, Madhurya. It is not an artificial switch. It's not like suddenly I will decide today I'm going to be Vatsalya, tomorrow I'm going to be Madhurya, tomorrow, you know, I'm going to be Sakya, not like that. That Sakya, Vatsalya, Madhurya, even Dasya is one of these four, is what is called as our constitutional position, our Swarupa. Prabhupada said Swarupa. Right? So, it is our Swarupa. We have to realize our Swarupa. Now, this Swarupa is already there. It is already, it exists. It has to be realized, or we have to realize what our Swarupa is and then serve the Lord in that mood. But this is called Prema. All these four are called Krishna Prema. So either we can serve Krishna in Dasya, or we can serve Krishna as a friend, Sakya, or we can serve Krishna as parents, Vatsalya. Or we can serve Krishna as his queens and gopis. This is Madhurya. Now, the interesting thing about Krishna Prema, which is the highest, I'm just talking about this because this is not possibly the right stage for us to discuss this, but because here there is mention about highest perfection of life, so I wanted to mention. With Vishnu, for example. Now there is please understand one thing, Vishnu and Krishna are non-different, the same person. It's like, you know, one candle, you light 100 candles, all those candles are the same. Okay, but still there is one candle which was the origin. That way, but all of them are same. Once they are there, they are all same. Right? Now, however, there is a difference in personality, characteristics, nature, right? Or what the Lord wants to demonstrate in that particular form, right? So in Vaikuntha, Venkateshwara, Balaji, Vishnu, Krishna demonstrates his Aishwarya Bhav, opulence. The mood of worship is also very opulent. You go to Tirupati, so great, grand, right? But it is all gold and, you know, it's like opulence. The Lord is with opulence. The mood is also of opulence. There is awe and reverence. So when we look at Lord, we'll say, oh Lord, you are so great. Isn't it? This is Vishnu. This is how we worship Vishnu. Now, worshipping Krishna in Goloka Vrindavan is very different. If you read Krishna book written by Srila Prabhupada, you will understand the mood in which the Vrajavasis, the inhabitants of Vrindavan, or Vrajadham, how they worship Krishna. How do they worship Krishna? So his friends go and sit on his shoulder. Right? Or they do mock fight with him. Yashoda Mata is taking a stick and binding Krishna to a wooden mortar. How can we understand? So this prema, this highest perfection of life, Krishna prema, is a mood where the devotees actually forget that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. They forget. As in, if they remember that Krishna is the Supreme Lord, then this highest level of prema cannot be exchanged. Just imagine if Mother Yashoda suddenly remembers, oh, Krishna is the Supreme Lord. Now, what will she chastise? What will she scold him? She's his mother. Nothing. How can she scold him or exchange love and affection and say, oh Lord, you know everything. You are the protector. Because when something was happening to Krishna, Yashoda always used to pray to Vishnu. Right? So time and again, that thought comes into their mind by Yoga Maya, she reveals that Krishna is the Supreme Lord, then again she makes them forget. So they forget that Krishna is the Supreme Lord. This is Krishna Prema. So Krishna Prema is a stage where we have to cross this Krishna is the Supreme, his Supreme stage. And then come to this stage, which is not artificial. Like I'm saying, we can't just say it from tomorrow, I'm going to be Vatsalya, or I'm going to be Sakya, or I'm going to be something. No. It is an eternal form that we have. Everybody, all of us. We will just realize it at that point of time. When do we realize this? When we achieve what is called as perfection of life. When we achieve perfection of bhakti, then we actually realize what our position is. How are we serving the Lord in Goloka? So this Krishna consciousness, the process that we are talking about, Shravanam, Kirtanam, Vishnu Smaranam, hearing, chanting, simple process, having prasadam, ABCD. The simple process will actually take us to that stage. It will take us to a stage where we will realize our actual position. It's not artificial. Realize means it is something that will dawn on us, or, you know, it's difficult to explain this word, realize. It's not artificial. We are not simply putting on some mask, right? It becomes our nature, that our nature becomes revealed and we become that. So then we want to serve the Lord in if our eternal bhava is vatsalya, then we want to serve Krishna in the mode of parents. If our eternal bhava is sakya, then we want to serve the Lord as friends. Like that natural mode will come in us. So when you look at Krishna, say, oh, I want to serve Krishna like this. So Krishna consciousness, this process of chanting Hare Krishna, takes us to that highest perfection of life. This faith is called Vyavasayatmika Buddhi. Okay. Now another way of understanding this Vyavasayatmika Buddhi. Vyavasaya. What is Vyavasaya? In Kannada, Vyavasaya means generally, you know, agriculture or specifically agriculture, but generally occupation. Occupation. Right? Is there anybody who comes from a business background? Business family? Anybody coming in business family? Okay. Generally, if anybody is coming from, you know, Gujarati, Marwadi, any of these business families, you know, you would have, oh yeah, okay, Supriya. So naturally, your mind is always running, he's always thinking about, you know, how do I make more money? Right? It's natural, actually, it's not artificial. It just comes and they have that knack. Of course, previously I've already told this before, saying that these Vaishyas, they were never used to use their intelligence to make money for themselves. They used to make money for the society, to help the society prosper. Anyway, and there were also very specific occupations they used to do. Krishi, Goraksha, Vanijya. Krishi is agriculture, Goraksha is cow protection, Vanijya is economy, exchange, barter. So that person, wherever that person is, he's sitting, sleeping, eating, he's always thinking, how do I make, how can I expand my business, what can I do, this. Right, so we should also be like that Vyavasayatmika Buddhi. Our intelligence should be always thinking, how can I serve Krishna, how can I serve Krishna, how can I engage in service of Krishna. So if we live like that, then we can achieve perfection of life. Now, when we are talking about this, Krishna didn't tell Arjuna saying that, you don't fight, I will take care of your fight. No. Like Rohit Prabhu said, Disha said, I think so, Rohit Prabhu said. So we should do our prescribed duty. Whatever is our duty. Like I have said previously, there is Purusha Dharma, there is Stri Dharma. Purusha Dharma is either Brahmana, Kshatriya, Vaishya or Shudra. Sri Dharma is Sri Dharma. So we do our duty as per the requirement. Right? But we always think about Krishna. We are always in the mood of serving Krishna. If we can live life in this way, then we can achieve perfection. Now if we don't live a life like this, like you said in the previous verse, we would have made some progress. We will continue the progress from next life. Now till we say, No, I don't want bhakti. If any of us independently say, I don't want bhakti, then you will lose bhakti because Krishna is not going to force bhakti on any of us. It is a matter of independence. Right? But generally also it is said that once somebody comes into Krishna consciousness, he can never forget the lotus feet of Krishna. We might go away from bhakti due to unfortunate circumstances maybe. But we will never forget the lotus feet of Krishna. Because when we are doing things in Krishna consciousness, things that are done in Krishna consciousness are not on the material plane. They are not like our work that we are going or we're going to some market. The same activity, right? Suppose we go to market for getting fruits, vegetables for ourselves versus getting fruits, vegetables for Krishna. That activity of buying fruits, vegetables for Krishna is not material. It's transcendental. It is above this material plane. But if we buy fruits and vegetables for ourselves, it is on the material plane and unfortunately it is going to give us karma, phala, punya or papa. But when you do things for Krishna, it doesn't have any punya or papa. It is akarma. It has no karma phala. So we should have this resolute determination saying that I want to achieve perfection in this life. Come what may. Whatever, let whatever come. I will depend on Krishna and fight on this path. with determination. That is what that, you know, that video was showing. Just complete faith in Krishna. And just go on, deal with life problems with full faith in Krishna. And go on with your bhakti, with your prescribed duties. But make sure that you don't drop bhakti. I've seen many devotees go through difficult times. Suddenly bhakti, they drop bhakti. Oh, time, I don't have time now. Don't ever drop bhakti. You can even drop your prescribed duty. Doesn't matter. Don't drop bhakti. It is the most precious thing. We don't even know. You know, we've got hold of this most precious jewel. The most precious thing in this creation. Not just in this creation. The whole, not just material creation. The whole creation of the Lord. Most precious thing is bhakti. Right? So for whatever reason, we should not drop it. Saying, I'll come back to it later. We may or may not come back to it later. Because our nature, our natural position in this material world is to forget the Lord. Right? So please chant Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna Maha Mantra is the only way by which we can achieve this perfection. And by chanting Hare Krishna, gradually we will, you know, we can remember Krishna. When you say Hare Krishna, Hare refers to Radharani. Krishna is, we are calling out Krishna. So we can, for a moment, at least Krishna will come into our minds. This is Krishna consciousness, right? So chant as much as possible. Right? And now this Krishna consciousness, Prabhupada is writing in the purport. If Krishna is satisfied by one's actions, everyone is satisfied. And also, he's saying one more thing. This resolute purpose. Vasudeva Sarvamiti Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. One who knows that Vasudeva Sarvam, Krishna is everything. Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. He is a Mahatma. He is a great soul. Mahatma. He is a great soul. And he is very, very rarely found. One who thinks that Krishna is everything is a very great soul who is very rarely found. And when we satisfy Krishna by our actions, by doing bhakti, over a period of time, everybody around us will become satisfied. It is like watering the root of the tree. When you water the root of the tree, automatically all the leaves and fruits and everything are watered, are nourished. Now, how do we do this service in Krishna consciousness? While now most of us are doing bhakti by our own effort, we've heard the process, so we are trying to practice. I'm hoping all of you are practicing. You're trying to practice bhakti every day, sadhana bhakti. Right, but here Prabhupada is saying, service in Krishna consciousness is best practiced under the able guidance of a spiritual master who is a bona fide representative of Krishna. And the guru should know the nature of the student and should guide him accordingly in Krishna consciousness. So it is imperative that all of us at some point of time accept a bona fide spiritual master. So fortunately, I've been accepted by bona fide spiritual master, His Holiness Bhakti Vikas Swami, many years back. And I'm trying to serve in under his guidance. Maharaj gives classes. So if you have time, please go to www.bvks.com, bvks.com, and hear his lectures. He speaks exactly what Srila Prabhupada spoke. Nothing more, nothing less. He's, you know, I remember when I was getting initiated, Maharaj said that initiation means that I ensure that all my disciples can read and understand Srila Prabhupada's books, can follow Srila Prabhupada's instructions. That's all his role is. Right? Very exalted soul. So, we should practice bhakti under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. All of us have to make progress towards it. Right? If we don't have a guru, previously this used to be a very normal thing. Everybody had a guru. No question of not having a guru. It is only nowadays that we are all self-made gurus. Right? But previously it was not like this. For spiritual things, actually for everything, there used to be a guru. Like music or sports or whatever, right? I mean, there's a guru. So for spiritual life also we need to have a guru. Right? So, and Prabhupada quotes one verse, yasya prasadat bhagavat prasado yasya prasadan nagati kutopi dhyayan swamsta seshasti sandhyam vande guru shri charanaravindam. So we should remember the lotus feet of the spiritual master three times a day. If he is pleased, then the Lord is pleased. If he is not pleased, then the Lord is not pleased. Is displeased. If he displeases the spiritual master, the Lord becomes displeased. So pleasing the spiritual master is the path to please Krishna. We cannot directly go and serve Krishna. We don't have that qualification. Shri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught us dasa dasa dasanu dasa. So we have to become servant of Krishna. Only then Krishna will accept us. So why is this guru, accepting a guru, being accepted by a guru important? Because we can serve Krishna only in parampara. Evam parampara praptam imam dadarsh radarsyo viduhu akalene mata yogo nashta parantapa. So only we can serve Krishna in parampara. Why only in parampara? So this parampara ISKCON is coming in Brahma Madhva Gaudiya Sampradaya. So if you open your Bhagavad Gita as it is, introduction, last page, there is a list of 32 acharyas, you know, through which this book that we are reading, Bhagavad Gita as it is, has come. The origin of this parampara is Brahma. Right? Brahma, Narada and so on. Right? So, why only parampara? And Srila Prabhupada and then, you know, Bhakti Vikas Swami, and then there are other gurus also in ISKCON. Why parampara? Krishna says that he can give moksha very easily. Padma Mataji said moksha, liberation. Krishna will give moksha very easily because moksha doesn't have any bhakti. Moksha is becoming one with the Lord. Krishna gives moksha very easily. But Krishna doesn't give bhakti easily. He gives mukti but not bhakti. Why he doesn't give bhakti? Because Krishna says once I give bhakti, Bhakta Paradino, he comes under the control of the devotee. Now Krishna has to be 100% sure if I as a soul am not going to cheat him, not going to misuse. Because see, Krishna, though is supremely powerful, when in a relationship with the devotee, he becomes like equal or lower also, right? Like Yashoda Mata is, you know, beating, is taking a stick to beat Krishna. Now Krishna has taken an inferior position. So in this bhakti, generally Krishna gives himself up to the devotee. So he is very concerned, oh, am I giving up myself to a right person, qualified person or not? So he doesn't accept us till we are recommended by somebody. Who can recommend us? In this parampara, people in the parampara can recommend. Right? So if I am accepted by my guru will recommend to his guru saying, oh, Guru Maharaj, please accept this devotee. He is interested in serving Krishna. Then he will offer to his guru. And like that, you know, it goes on and on and on. Finally, Brahma will offer to Radharani. And Radharani is the most favorite devotee of Krishna. Then Radharani offers to Krishna saying, Radharani is so humble. She is the topmost devotee. And she is so humble. See, whenever she looks at a new devotee, she says, oh, this devotee is serving better than me. Always her mood is like that, saying that I'm not serving Krishna nicely. So then she recommends to Krishna, Krishna, this is a nice devotee, please accept him. Then Krishna says, okay, Radharani, if you are recommending, then I will accept. So it's not some artificial process that we are just doing some bhakti. No, we have to get connected to the parampara. Only when we get connected to our parampara will we be actually formally be accepted by Krishna. Then Krishna will never leave us. Even if we leave Krishna. Even if we leave him, he will not leave us. He will keep coming behind us. How can I get this devotee back? How can I get this devotee back? So Prabhupada says the whole process, however, depends on perfect knowledge of the soul beyond the conception of the body, not theoretically but practically. when there is no longer a chance for sense gratification. So when we stop this business of sense gratification and engage in the service of the Lord, then we can make progress and gradually move towards this, you know, position of perfection in life, beyond which there is nothing to be accomplished. Actually, today, if we sit here and we say bhakti is the highest perfection, you know, we may not be able to completely appreciate it, because we still don't completely understand the position of a devotee. It is so powerful. It is so sweet. It is so dear to Krishna. I mean, there are multiple aspects of this relationship. Actually, there are so many things to say about this, maybe at a later point. Right? Like, devotee's position is like that. Position of a devotee is like that. Like I said, no, Krishna himself comes to his devotees. One of our acharyas, Madhavendra Puri, so he goes to this place called, now it's called Kheer Chor Gopinath, Remuna. He goes there to see the deity of Gopinath. I think then it was being called Gopal. So he goes there and he actually, before that in Vrindavan, in Govardhan, he would have got Gopal. Gopal actually, he actually is a deity, and he comes to Madhavendra Puri and, you know, gives him one. Madhavendra Puri is, you know, he's such that if some food doesn't come to him, he doesn't bother. He doesn't eat. He's always in chanting and in love of Krishna. So once what happens, he's sitting near the, you know, foothill of Govardhan. Last month we had gone there. It's so beautiful. You know, Govardhan, and he's chanting and he's not eaten anything. So Krishna is looking at his duty and saying, "Arey Baba, what is this? Madhavendra Puri Prabhu has not eaten anything." So then he comes himself, Krishna, with a pot of milk. He comes to Madhavendra Puri and gives the pot of milk, saying, "Baba, you know, you have not eaten anything." Madhavendra Puri is surprised. How does he know? It's okay, how do you know that I have not eaten anything? Says, see, in this village, there are all these cowherds and these women who are going this way to the get water. They saw you. You've been sitting here like this only. You've not eaten anything. We don't want anybody to starve in our village. So you please drink this. I will come back and then, you know, I will take the pot later in the day. So, okay, then Madhavendra Puri drinks. And when he drinks, he is like the taste of that milk he's never drunk before. So then he keeps thinking, who is this boy? How did he come to know? He's just thinking about it. Then he sleeps. He dozes. He is chanting. In the middle of the night, he dozes off. Then in his dream, the same boy comes. And he says, "Oh, Madhavendra Puri, please come here. My name is Gopal. I'm actually here. I'm the deity here, and I have been hidden under some grass and, you know, this one, because some Muslim invaders came and the pujari was afraid that they're going to hurt me, and then he hid me here. Please come and, you know, take me out. And it's very hot here." Right? So then Madhavendra Puri suddenly wakes up thinking, "Oh, what is this? Lord has come and given me an instruction." Then he goes, calls all the villagers, tells them what had happened. Then they go with all the required weapon and instruments, this, that, and all the tools. Go to that place where, which Gopal had indicated. Then they go dig that place. And then they find Gopal. And Madhavendra Puri is so happy. And then he establishes a temple on top of Govardhan. And, you know, even today, the worship is going on. The same Madhavendra Puri then goes. Then this Gopal tells Madhavendra Puri, saying that it's very hot. You know, I need some sandalwood paste. Sandalwood makes the body cool. That's why we apply chandan to the Lord in samadhi. So he says, go to Neelachal and you get from there. So Madhavendra Puri starts his travel and then he comes to this place. And here, this place is known for sweet rice that is offered to Gopinath. So the Lord is looking at Madhavendra Puri is looking at the Lord is so nicely, dressed and decorated and all that. And says, okay, this pot of sweet rice is world famous. And then the offering is going. Then Madhavendra Puri thinks for a minute, oh, if at all I can get a little taste of this, then I can see how it is made and then I can make the same sweet rice for my Gopal. Madhavendra Puri did not think, oh, if I can get this, you know, I can eat all of it. It is so nice. I'm heard. He didn't think about himself. He only thought about Gopal. But he doesn't want to ask, right? Because he doesn't ask anything. He just keeps quiet. And for a moment he thought, oh, why did I think like this? And then he just kept quiet. Normally, 7 pots are offered to the Lord. Right? What Gopinath does is he takes up 1 pot from that offering. So when the offering goes back, only 6 pots go back. Now 1 pot Gopinath has taken himself and hid it behind him, behind the curtain. He hid it. And then night, then Pujari puts the Lord to rest and then closes the temple, goes home, sleeps. Then in his dream, Gopinath comes. He says, there is 1 pot of sweet rice that is being near me here. You should give to this person called Madhavendra Puri. And then the pujari gets up and says, oh, what is this? And then he takes bath because you can't enter the temple without taking bath. He takes bath, opens the temple, goes where, sees where the Lord said that there is a pot of sweet rice and there is a pot of sweet rice. Then he comes out and he starts calling out loudly, who is this person by name Madhavendra Puri who is so fortunate? The Lord himself has stolen 1 pot of sweet rice for you. And then he goes and meets Madhavendra Puri and he falls at his feet and he said, what an exalted person are you? Lord, for your sake, he has stolen a pot of sweet rice. Like this, there are so many incidents in the lives of devotees. But the Lord personally comes, personally engages in their service. Right? So the position of a devotee is so superior, so dear to the Lord. And this position is the highest perfection of life. There is nothing else. There's nothing else more valuable in this world. So my humble request to everybody, please don't get distracted with this material world. This material world is a big distraction. Just treat it as a distraction. Take care of your duties to whatever extent is required. But go on practicing bhakti. Develop this desire today to become that, you know, dear devotee of the Lord. Because everything in this material world and spiritual world, it is all based on desire. If we desire to do something for the Lord, then Lord will empower us, give us the strength, give us the guidance to achieve it. And then there will be a lot of other disturbances, materially, even sometimes so-called spiritually, we might, you know, but we should not get bothered by these things. Just fix onto the process, follow the process seriously, and then we are sure to achieve perfection. Okay, so this is very important verse, actually one of the most important verses, verse 41. If possible, request you all to please read the purport from Srila Prabhupada's purport. It's very, very beautiful and informative. With those words, I'll stop here. Does anybody have any questions or comments?